Good morning, everyone. Am I on? And I'm on. All right. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship at West Guilford Baptist Church. I'm the senior pastor here, Shaun. Amy's going to wave her hand. She's the better half of the pastoral team, doing pastoral care and working with the kids and also helping lead in the music. We do have a few announcements this morning. Our first announcement is that's actually not our first announcement. It's a photo directory. I don't think there's one for this up there, but we are still taking names, D's at the back, for our new photo directory. There were somewhere around 58, 60 spots. There's only 18 left. So wonderful response from everybody. So make sure if you're not signed up yet for the photo directory, which is going to be an important thing for building community going forward, to please make sure that you sign up for that. And along with that, if you're new and we don't have your information in front of you or behind you, you will find one of these new member sheets. Please fill it out, and just help us to get to know you. If you're even if you're just a guest, and help us to get to know you, you can click. You can check if you want more information about our church. If you want a mail folder, offering envelopes, or a visit from one of the members of our pastoral team, and you just put that in the offering box, which I always seem to forget to mention. There is an offering box as you leave the church there. On the left on the table. And is the information D going to be on the table still there, or they just come see you?
I'll be there with the book.
She'll be, so the two for one. You get the book and you get D standing beside the book at the back when you go out. So please make sure. I'm excited. I think it's going to be a great time. And we've meant to have portraits taken for years, so this is going to be your opportunity. You do get a free portrait and you do get a free book out of that. It doesn't cost you anything. You can purchase more pictures if you'd like. Monday at 10:30 a.m. is Kingdom Prayer Time. And we did discuss. It came up with the leadership to possibly, this is a good start for our fellowship time, to bring a bag lunch afterwards. So bring a bag lunch afterwards. We'll have some coffee, tea, and maybe some juice as well. And we'll start breaking bread together in the comfort of Monday after our Kingdom Prayer Time at 10:30. Next one is, I want to make sure I'm lining up, Sunday School. There's still a ministry opportunity for Sunday School. It doesn't look like we have Sunday School this morning, but we have for the last 2 or 3 weeks. We will have it this morning. Okay, we're going to have a short one with our kids this morning downstairs. Amy's going to take the opportunity. But if you're interested in teaching for Sunday School, please talk to Amy. There's some training that has to happen and some checks that we need to do. Obviously, we want to keep our community safe, but an exciting opportunity for ministry there. There is a deacons meeting. I believe that's the next one. Deacon meeting Tuesday, August 22, that is this Tuesday at 1:30. Obviously, it's an open forum. You're welcome to come kind of sit in the back and see what is discussed during the deacons meeting. I think sometimes we open it up for questions, Heather, if I'm not mistaken, but normally it's the deacons discussing such important things as what brand of coffee to buy. So it'd be thrilling. Prayer at the Train is still going to be happening. This is for Youth for Christ. Youth Unlimited, Youth for Christ are looking at, you know, what's ministry look like in Halliburton for them going forward, but what's ministry look like for the churches as well? So it's a great opportunity for prayer. Also want to mention, finally, blue Bibles are available at the back. If you don't have your own Bible or you didn't bring one, please feel free to go grab one. If you don't own one or you just like a copy of the ESV, please feel free to take it home with you. That's a gift from Amy and I to you. Also, for any young people, any young at heart, there's activity sheets available at the back there, too. There is a word search, which I'm a little bit disposed to doing word searches when they're available, so that would have been me. I'm going to invite the worship team to come up, and we're going to have our call to worship. Philippians chapter 2, starting at the 9th verse. We just take a moment to welcome the Lord into our midst. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Amy's going to lead us in some pastoral prayers, and then we'll have our worship time.
Let's pray together. Lord God, it's a joy to come into your presence. We love you, Lord, and we worship you. And Lord, we just lay at your feet the cares that we have. Some of us have had really difficult weeks. Some of us have had weeks of profound joy. And in every way that we come to you, Lord, we come. We come to you. We just take a moment to offer up the names of people we would like to pray for. And so, community, I invite you to say quietly or aloud the names of people that you would like to pray for this morning. So, Lord, we lay these people at your feet and in your hand, trusting in you and in your care. Lord, we ask for your mercy and your comfort for those who are grieving. We pray for your healing for those who are sick and injured. And for those who are injured in heart, we're sick in spirit, Lord. We are all in need of your healing in some way. And we ask for that, Lord Jesus. God, I pray for the strength of this community. I pray that you would bind us together in your love, that you would make us a community that adores and worships you well and in a way that glorifies you. All of these things we ask in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Oh, all right, let's stand together and sing to God.
Glorious things of thee are spoken. Words cannot be broken, formed before. Through your
can always run to Jesus. Amen. Thank you, worship team. Kids are going downstairs. Perfect. Now, when I was growing up, probably the same as many of as a lot of you will remember, TV shows were still in 30-minute segments. You know, these days, in the days of Netflix and in the days of YouTube, that's not so much the case anymore. But when I was growing up, most shows just went 30 minutes. And sometimes, if it was a big deal, they'd cross over two different weeks and they'd separate it. Remember, they'd have that, the big season finale maybe would last an hour. Star Trek was great for that. Actually, Star Trek was an hour, but they would have the season finale and then they'd leave it on a cliffhanger. And then you'd be left all summer wondering what's going to happen to Captain Picard. And then in September, you would find out. And at the beginning of that second show, they would always have, someone would say, would come on, a narrator, or maybe even one of the characters would come on and say, you know, previously on Star Trek. And then they kind of tell you what would happen. And you get a flashback there. Then there would be a backstory, just in case maybe you missed it. Or if you're like me and you were busy all summer working at your parents' store, you forgot what had happened. But there would be a backstory, because the backstory, of course, was very key on understanding what was going to come next and understanding the trajectory of the story. If you don't get the backstory, you really don't understand what it is that's coming next. And I kind of feel that from a cultural perspective, if we think about it, a backstory does kind of the same thing. A backstory culturally tells you about who a people are. When I would go overseas, one of the things I would often do is go to a museum. We'd actually take people to a museum to get some cultural awareness, we called it. Because when you learn the backstory of a people, you get a sense of who those people are. Our kids went with the Vacation Bible School to the museum here in Halliburton. I thought that was great. Get a sense of who Halliburton is and who the people of Halliburton are. And so we're getting a sense of a backstory from Acts. We're getting the biblical narrative from Acts. Our next slide, please. We're getting the biblical narrative. As we define who we are into the future, we're getting a sense of our backstory and who we have been from the beginning and from the beginning of our story as the church. We're following the disciples in that first church through Acts, and we're at a point where basically we're getting a sense of what the church has done since the beginning. What are the things they've done? Last week, right from the very beginning, we learned the church had four marks. That there was teaching that happened, teaching what the apostles taught, the fellowship, the breaking of bread, and prayer. And this week, we're going to see from the beginning, Christian ministry has from the start reached out to the margins. Has reached out to the margins and to the messiness of people's lives. Right from the start, the power of God meets people in the messiness of their lives and calls us as a church, I believe, to ministry on the margins. So if you have your Bible with you, if you don't, again, there's some available at the back, the blue ones at the back. We're going to read right through chapter 3 of Acts. Let's pray together. Loving God, I come to you this morning, Lord God, humbly just asking that you would make me a vessel, just as you did the worship team this morning, that help people come and know you and have a presence of the living God, and only the truth would be spoken, and that only the truth would be heard. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So Acts 3, starting at the first verse. Now Peter and John were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour, and a lame man from birth was being carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, that is called the Beautiful Gate, to ask alms of those entering the temple. Seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked to receive alms, to receive something from them, some money from them. And Peter directed his gaze at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. But Peter said, "I have no gold and silver, but what I do have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and raised him up, and immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. And leaping up, he stood and began to walk and entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God and recognized him as the one who sat at the beautiful gate of the temple asking alms. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. While he clung to Peter and John, all the people, utterly astounded, ran together to them at the portico called Solomon's. And when Peter saw it, he addressed the people, "Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this? Why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers glorified his servant Jesus, who you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate when he had decided to release him. But you denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked for a murderer to be granted to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses, and his name, by faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know, and the faith that is through Jesus has given the man this perfect health in the presence of you all. And now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. But what God foretold by the mouth of the prophets, that this Christ should suffer, he thus fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and turn back, that your sins may be blotted out, and that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring of all the things about which God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets long ago. Moses said, 'The Lord God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brothers. You shall listen to him in whatever he tells you. And it shall be that every soul who does not listen to that prophet shall be destroyed from the people.' And all the prophets who have spoken from Samuel and those who came after him also proclaimed in these days, 'You are the sons of the prophets and of the covenant that God made to your fathers, saying to Abraham, and in your offspring shall all the families of the earth be blessed. God, having raised up his servant, sent him to you first to bless you by turning every one of you from your wickedness.'" This is the word of the Lord. We are very thankful to God for his word. Again, we're going through large segments and not small segments, so we're kind of picking up steam as we go through Acts here. So where are we this week? We are still in Jerusalem. The new church, even though they've preached to the diaspora, to all these Jews who have come from all around from all the nations around them, from both of the empires around them, and you can kind of feel that something's about to happen. There's kind of tremblings. We haven't left Jerusalem yet. We're still just at the starting line of the church. Peter and John are at the temple. The verse 3:1 says are at the temple for prayers. This is a model of the temple that you can find in Jerusalem right now. So they're there. Peter and John were part of Jesus' inner circle along with James. There were those who were disciples, but those three, they were specially mentored by Jesus. And so we see Peter and John here taking up that leadership role that Jesus spent years mentoring them through failures and through successes. And now we see, especially Peter here, taking that leadership role. There were morning, afternoon, and evening prayers at the temple. And the morning and the afternoon prayers, they happened at the same time that there were sacrifices happening in the temple. And so when this says that they're there at the ninth hour, they're there for the second prayer, they're there for the afternoon. So it's the afternoon heat has hit. We can kind of feel that. There's the daily sacrifices about to happen. And they are coming up to the beautiful gate. And so the beautiful gate is right here. We believe. It's actually this gate called Beautiful that Acts talks about, one of the few details in Acts that isn't corroborated by some of the other sources in history that we have. But we believe, according to the description that we have here, that it is the Nankor Gate, which was made of pure bronze. And it faced out to the east. And so when the sun rose, it was an amazing, beautiful sight, the gate was. And so they called it the Beautiful Gate. And so Peter and John are headed up the steps to the Beautiful Gate in the middle of the day. And they're located at the Beautiful Gate. You see the steps that are there. The Beautiful Gate is located 15 steps from the point that those who weren't able to go in and worship in the temple could make it up to. Okay? So when you go up these steps, the sick and the lame, or any of those who according to the law, couldn't come into the temple, they couldn't go past 15 steps from the beautiful gate. So all along here, we have this story of this man is one of the people who's brought in and laid there, and they're begging, asking for alms of the people who are going up. So these are just all kinds of people here. And so Peter and John are heading up there, and for some reason, this man calls out to them as they're going up the steps. And we want to be fair to the Jewish tradition at the time, because it was far different than if this was a pagan temple. All right, so understanding who this man is, he wouldn't have been destitute. The Jewish tradition at that time, actually, they had a very, very favorable view of charity and supporting those who are sick and lame. And so if you were begging on these steps, it's highly probable you actually wouldn't have been destitute. If this had been a pagan temple, good luck. All right? But let's be fair, in the Jewish tradition, a wonderful view of charity. So he wouldn't have been destitute, but there's no hiding the fact that he's on the outside looking in on Jewish life. Simply because he has an infirmity, he's not allowed within 15 steps of that gate, and certainly not allowed to go in to worship with his family and to worship with his community. So the definition, if I was to define marginal, here's my welcome and announcement sheet that I have here. You know, the margins, they're always a spot where I try to get the printer to print, and then the printer doesn't print. It cuts off my head or something like that in a picture, right? And so when we talk about a marginalized person, you know, here's the part of the page that you can draw on. There's the part of the page you can't draw on. He is a marginalized individual, pushed to the edges. Not completely lost, but still pushed to the edges of the page culturally. The definition of marginal, where the printer can't print. So the man approaches them in 3:3. Seeing them about to go into the temple, he asks to receive alms. And he may have just said it. He's not looking at them after that point, so he's probably just asking as many people as possible who are going. So here's someone who the religious system has cast off. Here's someone who's on the margins, but Jesus doesn't cast him off. Do we see the contrast? The religion casts him off, but Jesus doesn't cast him off. God doesn't cast him off. That's a vision. The disciples here, the apostles here, are giving us a vision of who God is. God is the one, he's the God of the people on the margins. He's the God who loves them and welcomes them and brings them wholeness. He's the God who welcomed and brought me wholeness, even though I didn't deserve it. So even though the world turns its eyes from the man, we see in verse 3-4, the disciples look at him. And I want to just imagine that for a moment. I want to imagine how invisible this man would have used to have been to the people who were going by. When I was in Toronto, I did schooling in Toronto somewhere. Where were we at, Amy? I think we were right up there, right where the white part and the cement part. That's about where my school was, right there at U of T at the time. And there was a fellow student who was there, Paul. Amy will remember Paul. She knew him for years. He was an inner-city missionary. Beautiful soul. Beautiful, wonderful guy who's just a heart big enough for the world. And he used to host what he called sandwich runs. He actually had T-shirts made up of a sandwich running. And we would go out, and this is what a sandwich run would look like. He'd organize groups of students, and he'd load up our backpacks with sandwiches and socks. For a homeless person in Toronto, two important things are fresh socks and food. And so he'd load us up with sandwiches and socks, and he'd send us out in the night to Yonge Street and to Bay Street and all these areas. And basically, we were going to hand out sandwiches and to hand out socks. But he challenged us. He said, don't just hand out the sandwich. He wanted us to engage. He wanted us to sit down and get to know these people who God loved so much and wanted us to reach out to. So we'd sit down and we'd chat, but there was a purpose to why we would sit down and we would chat. And he had this purpose. And this was it. There was something that he wanted us to experience. As you sit beside a homeless person in Toronto, One thing that hits you the moment you sit down is you become instantly invisible. It was mind-blowing to me, to Shaun from Halliburton, that I would sit down and the people walking by, it was like I was invisible to them. And there was this weird parallel reality that street people in Toronto live in. 3 feet from other people and being almost completely invisible. The odd person will drop off money. But even then, you know, there's something over there. There's, you know, anything but actually engaging and looking. Mind-blowing to me at that time. And so when the people vaguely will recognize him as someone who was a beggar, because he's probably there since his youth. His experience, friends, could not have been much different. In fact, probably was very similar to the street person in Toronto. On a day-to-day basis, as people went up to worship, there would have been this parallel, invisible reality. But the disciples, the difference here is a disciple of Christ sees him. He's a child of God to them. Someone just as worthy as them for grace, because that is who God is in Christ. And that is who God calls us to be. And friends, if we look at verse 6, that's when the miracle happens. Verse 6. But Peter said, I have no silver and gold, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And I want to tell you, I'm not completely anti-mystical. Healings do happen when you pray. I've seen it happen. I've seen healings, actual healings happen. However, none of us are the apostles a couple of weeks after Pentecost, right? Biblically, this seems like a very special time for the church. There were certain apostles who had that get up and walk kind of power, where they just reached out, get up and walk, and someone would get up. Paul had that certain power. However, Paul's power and Peter's power here was special and unique enough that the Bible mentions it in contrast to others. It was a special thing that Paul had this get up and walk kind of power. So the call of Acts 3 isn't for all of us to be mystical healers with get up and walk kind of power. But what is the call? As I read it, in context, I think the call is that we are called to wade into the lives of the people God puts in front of us. We are called to love those who even the world pushes aside. Those who are in tough times and the world would try to shield their eyes from that. We are called to wade in, to love them, and to speak and to pray in Jesus' name. To me, that's the call of Acts 3. And basically, give the Spirit the room to move in the lives of his people. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, they pray for him. And the Lord turns the mourning into dancing, as the Bible talks about, literally leaping. And I want to make a key point here. Okay, the man's physical need isn't just met. He isn't lame anymore. Can you take us back a slide? Maybe it's back. So he isn't lame anymore. He can now worship. It's not just his physical ailment that is cured here. It's the ailment that was keeping him from experiencing God and worshiping. So he's welcomed in. What a wonderful healing has happened. Now, you can take that forward a couple of times now. There, thank you. And so he is leaping, verse 3:8 says, fulfilling the prophecy of Isaiah 35:6, and the lame man shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the mute shall sing for joy. And the people are just filled with wonder and amazement. Could you imagine? You're a part of this community. He's invisible day to day, but at the same time, they're kind of like, wait a minute, isn't that Ted from the steps? And he's leaping and he's dancing. I know his parents maybe. And all of a sudden, you know, I know his backstory. And it opens a path for the gospel, not only for him, but for the people around him. If we look at verse 11, well, he clung to Peter, all the people utterly astounded. My gosh, look at Ted, ran together to them in the portico called Solomon. So Peter and John have moved to what's called Solomon's porch. Their prayers have probably ended, so people can actually interact now. And so they're over in Solomon's porch, which is this building over on this side. And that's oftentimes when you see pictures of the disciples in the temple, it's pictures of them in the porch, or if you see Jesus there as well. And so that's where they've moved to, and people run to catch up with him. When Jesus turns someone's life around, friends, it reverberates to the entire community. And that's what we see there. And this is happening over and over and over again through Acts. And that's how the church is built. And in verses 12 to 16, the disciples don't miss that opportunity. It was a long section, but I went through it because they preach the gospel and they preach salvation through Jesus from verses 17 to 20. The physical healing here serves a purpose, not only for that individual, but to point to the healing everyone needs, and to point to healing that we all need to be healed of our existential sickness, our separation from God. The Bible calls this sin. And now when you hear sin from your Sunday school time, you might hear, you know, bad. But I want us to start thinking, changing our moving our minds a little bit to be more biblical in how we think about sin and the power of sin and this existential, this mystical sickness that we all have. It's not so much bad, well, it is badness, but it's not just badness. It starts with awayness. We are away from God. We are in the outer courts of the temple, unable to go in our own hearts. We are all sick, just like this man. I want to read you a passage. And I want you to pinpoint for me a term that gets repeated. Okay, this is from 2 Corinthians 5, starting at the 18th verse. All this, tell me what you hear repeated. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled to us himself and gave us a ministry of reconciliation, that in God, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against him, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Easiest test you've ever had. What's the word that's repeated over and over again there? Reconciliation. We have been given a ministry of reconciliation because the world is away from God. That is the root of sin. When we start thinking about sin, the bad things I do or the ways that I act away from God are because my heart is away from God. It is the result, and I need to be reconciled to Jesus. The badness in our life is a natural result of our wayness from God. Without Jesus, we are all spiritually lame. We are all on the courts on the outside because we are away from God. And friends, the cross, this beautiful cross that's been made for us here, the cross is the bridge. And the bridge brings us into a relationship with God. We once were spiritually sick, and now we have been brought near. We were lame, just like the man in our passage. And God has brought us near. This is, yes, this is a healing about a man in Jerusalem in the early centuries of the church, but it's a message about all of us, friends. It's a message about all of us. The healing of the man's body is the healing we all need, and they all need it in their lives. The only difference between the man and everyone else is his need was on the outside. That nagging sense you have, friends, that something in life is missing or isn't just right is because something in life is missing and it isn't right. It's time to turn to Jesus, accept the cross, and our passage says that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord because you have been brought near to the presence of the Lord into your life. So wading into the life of this outsider, reaching to his greatest point of need, opens the way to preaching Jesus to all those around him. From the start, the power of Jesus has met people in the messiness of their lives. And friends, we are called, just like the disciples, right from the start to a ministry on the margins, in our midst, here, when people are feeling run over by life, but also with those outside who the world has pushed aside. And so why does this matter? There's an evergreen tree called the lodgepole pine. And this is a remarkable tree. You see versions of it all the way across North America, especially I think it's Yellowstone Park. There's tons of them. And so the pine cones are serotonous. I don't know if I said it right, but it makes me sound fun, smart. So the pine cones of Serotonin, if you know, if they're not, and you know it, maybe Lori might be able to tell me, I don't know, but I sound smart. All right, so basically what that means is these pine cones will hang on the tree for years. They don't even grow them until the tree's 10 years old, and they'll hang there for years. And even after the pine cone falls, it won't open. But God has a reason for this. The pine cone, when a forest fire rages through the forest and takes everything down, that intense heat actually opens the pine cone. And they are the first tree to grow after a forest fire in many areas. The heat of the fire actually creates new life. There's something about the messiness of life and the challenges that we all go through and life on the margins that opens humans to God and opens our hearts. Those intense moments of life, hearts can open and the Spirit can finally take hold. I've seen it happen in the lives of people who have seemingly walked away from the Lord. But then in those moments where the fire of life is upon them, you know what I mean when I say that? You know, those little lessons that they learned in Sunday school, call them deeper. And it happens in the lives of faithful Christians. New growth we didn't know was going to happen. God uses the messiness of life to call us deeper into Him. When the crack in our exterior happens and the light of the Spirit is able to come into our hearts. From the start, the church was speaking into the messiness of people's lives. So I think we have a response this morning. In two ways, a response this morning. First, let's be a real church. And what do I mean by a real church? Not like, you know, you can feel the walls, it's real. But one of the reasons... One of the responses that we actually received from my talk in the park was that people are tired of playing pretend at church. People are tired of just acting like everything's okay, I'm okay, you're okay, everything's just okay. And then for someone at the front to share those challenges, and I didn't know if I was going to do that, it wasn't even on my sheet, that was just the Holy Spirit saying, Shaun, now's the time. And so to hear that feedback was very affirming for us. Some things aren't great. Surprise. Sometimes life can be a challenge. Surprise. God prizes our holiness more than trouble-free days, so hard things are allowed into our lives, maybe to crack the exterior and let the Holy Spirit in. No one is perfect. We are all on the margins in some way. But these friends are opportunities to care for one another. And you're very good at that. That's why we've just loved coming into your midst in this church. Well, let's just continue to do that. Preach the gospel to one another in those times when we need it most. The death of loved ones, addictions in the family, recovery from trauma. I know the statistics about trauma. Studied them very well. Recovery from trauma, an opportunity to love and speak to one another. Let's continue to be real with one another. That's the call of Acts 3, I think. I love our prayer chain. Call our prayer chain. Let us pray for you if you're going through things. Let us visit you. Let us bring you food. Let us love you. It does as much for us as it does for you. We want to be a real church. Amen? Amen. Second, we want to be intentional as a community to welcome and love those who the world pushes to the margins. As we go forward, this is going to be an important point. Example, there are those who are pushed aside for mental or for physical or mental situations the world says isn't optimal. You're not optimal, you go to the side. That's how it works. And it's something, but the Lord says, no, no, there is no margins in the Lord's world. He loves you. And I would say Jesus had a particular love for people on the margins. Something important to keep in mind, friend, as we look forward as a church here. We're not a church of worldly elites. We're a church of recovering sinners, helping each other bear one another's burdens towards holiness by the way of the cross. From the start, the apostles were intentionally open and loving to people on the margins in the messiness of their lives, speaking healing to those religious elites. The religious elites would cast off, speaking love to those who the world considered unlovable. And it wasn't easy. It got them into a lot of trouble. We're going to see that throughout Acts, but they did it anyways, because Jesus had healed them eternally, and God loved them when they were unlovable. That's the dance of ministry in a messy world. So let's dance with the Spirit out to the margins. So our big finish, one of the things I'm struck by through the Gospels is Jesus' affinity for the outsider. It would seem like if there was someone who was forgotten by society, they had a physical, a mental, or a spiritual ailment, that's where Jesus went in the Gospels. People flocked to him because of it. Imagine the beauty of that. Imagine being in the ancient world and the beauty of the hope that Jesus provided, those crowds of just the lost and the unloved coming for welcome, coming for love, coming for healing. That, friends, is our Savior, whose Spirit is active and alive in your heart and in my heart through the faith in Jesus. So I want us to grab hold of that vision this week, that beautiful Savior we're singing about, and pray God helps us experience him in that way, and also to live it in our lives. Let's pray together. Loving God, you call us out in surprising ways, to surprising people, at surprising times, when we welcome the Holy Spirit, like the apostles did at Pentecost. So we welcome your Holy Spirit, Lord God. We ask that you make us a church that does ministry in the margins, in our midst, but also reaching out to those, Lord God, those special people that you've given us to love in our community. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to invite the worship team to come back up.
Let's stand and sing together.
Exalted on high, I will praise him.
Loving God, you are exalted on high, and we just praise you, Lord God. We praise you with our hearts, with our voices. Help us to praise you with our lives this week. Receive now the benediction from Romans 15. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accordance with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Have a great week, everybody. God bless.